It is 7:33 in the Twin Cities. Well, if you have kids, you know it's always one of the toughest situations to try and figure out a good daycare or early childhood center for your little one. And also, in terms of those centers and in terms of education as a career, it's something where they are looking for new teachers. And it is a lifestyle. It's a very satisfying career, but it's also one that involves a fabulous lifestyle opportunity as well. Joining us to talk about this is local education expert Elise McGregor. Elise, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you.
All right. Well, listen, you have found like one center called Little Newtons. Tell us about that.
So the center Little Newtons that I created was made to be different than others. So we teach them five languages. We have lower ratios than state requirements, and I designed it to be different. And we've since expanded into Maple Grove, Champlin, and we're continuing to span throughout the Twin Cities.
All right. And what's the age group that you deal with?
We do 6 weeks through 5 years. We do have a private kindergarten.
Okay. And what, I think people are probably going, wow, that this place sounds really awesome. I mean, can you just share with us sort of the cost of your centers?
Yeah, we actually are lower than most other centers, and that was my plan, was to keep our costs low. And we provide diapers, wipes, baby food, formula, and all the meals. And we're about, I don't know, $30 less than everyone else, $40
wow.
less a week.
Okay, and it's an expensive proposition. I know that you want to talk about the advantages of being and becoming a teacher. Is there a shortage of teachers right now?
You know, I think in the early education field there is, because it's a very demanding job, and it's a job that has a lot of high turnover. And so I think a lot of the people that typically are going to school to be a teacher, they're striving for a public school or a private school, not as much early education.
All right. But so you're saying, and I would think more and more people, if they can afford it, are trying to get that early education. Right now we've got mandatory kindergarten in Minnesota, yep. and which has been an enormous success. And, you know, I mean, the percentage of people that are enrolling has exceeded the expectations. It's almost every single kid that's doing it. In terms of sort of these other, you know, younger than kindergarten, what kinds of opportunities are there out there?
You know, I think centers for that age group that's underneath kindergarten, centers are also growing. And so in turn, there's a high demand for those teachers. And I think you really have to figure out a way to retain the teachers and to promote them within to keep building your staff base.
All right. Is this a good time to get into teaching?
I think so, especially with the high demand and the amount of centers and early education opportunities that are out there. At Little Newtons, we just started a student loan repayment program and tuition reimbursement for two reasons. One, to get to keep our teachers that we have, but also to be able, with the standards of the Department of Human Services and what they require, to be able to get the people started on their career and continue to have them grow.
And what, in terms of early childhood education, I mean, what are the standards if you want to be a teacher in the state of Minnesota at this early childhood level, and then also at the, you know, preschool or elementary school level?
You know, it's funny, the qualifications are really variable, and I didn't know that going into that, but you could have somebody that has a four-year degree versus someone that has 9 credits but a whole lot of experience. And then within that, they have about 6 different combinations, the Department of Human Services, 6 different combinations. And then you could also get a variance. So if you have all of the credits and 50% of the experience, then they'll grant you a variance so you can continue to work with that experience, or vice versa.
I see. And is this for, are we talking for like all ages, or is this for just at the preschool?
This is for early childhood.
Okay. And in terms of the benefits and the salaries? I mean, obviously, you know, a lot of people will say, you know, teachers are underpaid. They do get a benefit, though, in terms of the vacations and also certainly the summer vacations as well as the other vacations. I mean, how does that work out? Because it's still not, you've got a lot of education invested. We all know that college is super expensive. I mean, you were mentioning that your school has, you know, these tuition reimbursements, but in terms of salaries, what are you looking at when you get into early childhood education?
You know, it is not a high-paying job, and I think that a lot of the teachers, at least that I employ, they are doing it for the satisfaction or the enjoyment out of it, and the range can be between, you know, $13 and $16 an hour for a lead teacher. And like you said, coming out of college, they're saddled with a lot of student loan, and it's very trying to be working at that, you know, rate and trying to pay off your student debt and buy a house and all of the other things that they're looking at.
I mean, that's almost impossible, really.
Right.
You know, so how do you find people who are, who want to do that?
A lot of them are going to school while, while they're working. And then, you know, we offer the incentive so that we can help take that burden of their student loan, because I understand that they're trying to, you know, further their education. And a lot of the teachers that we get meet the qualifications for, you know, the Department of Human Services, but they're, you know, not fully through school. And so it's something that they're working on and not, you know, they don't have their teacher's license quite yet.
Are any people, are you seeing any kind of trend of people choosing it sort of as a second career? Maybe they've, you know, gotten to the point where they're, you know, maybe approaching retirement and, you know, they're opting for this?
Yeah, and we have also had people that come through and, you know, I look at their qualifications and they have had a lot of experience and I'm thinking, gee, we have to be fair for all of our pay, but they really are doing it because it's a second career or they really love children and they want, they're passionate about making the difference in their life. And that's one thing that I would say all of my teachers do feel our program is educating them, and they feel very passionate about it.
All right. We are chatting with education expert Elise McGregor. In terms of the ratios that are required by the state, what are the ratios when it comes to early childhood education?
So for infants, it's one caregiver to four children. For toddlers, it's 1 to 7. And for preschool, it's 1 to 10. And so what we do is we add one more staff member in that ratio so that, you know, it's a high burnout type of career. And if you just have that extra hand, the children are getting taken care of better or more effectively. And the teachers kind of feel like the burden isn't all on themselves. Now, if we have those ratios and someone calls in, for example, sick, we don't have a sub for those ratios. We always maintain state ratios.
Right. And again, the qualifications, because it sounds like it's a little bit over the map, all over the map. It can be. Can you explain that part again?
Yeah, it really is, because they require a lead teacher, for example, has to have a certain number of credits and 2,000 hours in a licensed center. So, you know, if you were a volunteer, that would count, but it would have to be in a licensed center. If you had 2 years of experience or 2 years of credit and experience, you could be an assistant teacher. It's just they have so many different qualifications that it's not cut and dry for early childhood.
And when you're saying a licensed center, that would not mean like if you had experience in a home daycare, that wouldn't count.
Correct. It would have to be we're licensed by Rule 3. And so it'd have to be in a Rule 3 type setting or something of that nature.
Okay. And, you know, are most of the kids that come to your centers, do they stay there through the whole time?
Yep.
And are there programs in the summer?
Yes, we're year round.
Okay. And in terms of, you know, differences in terms of, you know, centers, I mean, you actually mentioned language teaching. At what age do you guys start language teaching?
We actually started in our infant rooms because the philosophy behind the center is that even a very little baby can learn a huge breadth of information. So our infant teachers are going through the curriculum and, you know, teaching them these languages. And while they can't talk it back to us or speak it back to us, we can see a big growth pattern between infants and toddlers when they do start acquiring that language. And what the research shows is that children that are exposed to second languages or any other language, their vocabulary skills are so high at such a young age.
Okay. All right. Well, Lisa McGregor, thank you so much for joining us. We certainly appreciate it tonight.
You too. Thank you very much.
Take care.